He said once, "I don't like it at home, but I can't bear it anywhere else." I think he felt it was a kind of refuge. He had to come back here.
All you needed to worry about was the other people, because Nick's guitar would always be right. Nick's voice would always be right.
Nicholas Rodney Drake. Nicholas Rodney Drake, or more simply, Nick Drake, was a singer-songwriter and folk musician who was born in Rangoon in Burma on the 19th of June 1948, born to Molly and Rodney Drake.
Nick Drake was quite an underrated artist at his time. He only managed to find success after his passing, unfortunately, which is very unfair, I think, to him and to him himself.
To say the least, a cult icon to music fans around the world. This man will be our case study for this video, and he will be the key to answering the very question that we will be focusing on today. What the heck happened to Nick Drake? Nick's mother, Molly Drake, was also a musician and a poet, and Nick's music is considered to be influenced greatly by her music. The song How Wild the Wind Blows is a good example of the bleak and empty mood some of Nick Drake's music carries on, especially in the latter years of his life. Here's an excerpt of Poor Mum, written in the 40s, not long after Nick was born.
Poor Mum, after a lifetime of dreaming. Poor Mum, whatever became of your scheming? Nothing worked out in the way that you planned. Nothing was quite as you thought. Try very hard not to misunderstand. Joy as it flies cannot be caught. Poor Mum.
After living in Burma for 9 years, Nick's family moved back to England in 1957, where he attended Eagle House boarding school in Berkshire, where some of his teachers described Nick as quietly authoritative. This may just be that Nick was naturally shy and not very outgoing during his time. That wouldn't necessarily be considered depression or any other mental illness. Just a personality trait that many people of his age have. But at the same time, this could also be a sign of things to come. It almost seemed impossible to tell back then, as it's almost impossible to say now. In 1967, Nick started attending New University in France, to which him and his friend described their time at university as a 3-year holiday. This was when Nick started to smoke cannabis, and most likely started to take LSD as well.
I think we felt we were a little bit sort of superior, and I was the guy who smoked more dope than anybody else, and I'm the guy who went on and had drug problems sort of later on. But there was this, it was really a 3-year holiday, and Nick would go off and he would just play his guitar. I mean, I'd sometimes go and see him up in Fitzwilliam, and he would just be playing the same riff over and over again, and he always made it look effortless. I was always very struck by his guitar playing, because I would sort of strum Beatles songs or something, but he was playing this folky, bluesy style that was always very clean and great precision, and he could repeat it over and over again and just go on and on for hours playing this amazing riff with, you know, interesting finger picking and stuff. It just amazed me. And we never actually did a whole lot.
In late 1967, Nick met Robert Kirby, who was responsible for all of the orchestral parts in Nick's first 2 albums. And by that time, he had grown interest in the folk scene that had emerged in the early 60s. His early songs are influenced by artists such as Jackson C. Frank and Bob Dylan. During some of his live performances, Ashley Hutchins from the band Fairport Convention had noticed him and was not only impressed by his guitar playing, but the image of his playing. He looked like a star. He looked wonderful. He seemed to be 7 feet tall, he said. This is when he introduced him to Joe Boyd, who would ultimately become his producer for the first 3 albums he would later conceive. And by 1968, he started work on his first album, 5 Leaves Left. He showed no signs of depression, but one of the songs, which would foreshadow what would have been the stigma for his depression, was released on this album, Fruit Tree. a song that almost seemed to predict the very fate that would befall him in the latter years.
Fame is but a fruit tree, so very unsound. It can never flourish till its stalk is in the ground. So men of fame can never find a way till time has flown far from their dying day. Forgotten while a year, remembered for a while. A much updated ruin from a much outdated style.
Well, his first two albums, I don't think they're his masterpieces. They're all that great. Like, Five Leaves Left is a bit on the poppy side. It's got the strings. It's not really the straight folk that I was expecting when I first heard of Nick Drake.
Despite the album selling poorly, only 10,000 copies, Nick didn't give up there. Even if the album's post-production took longer than expected, delaying the album by a few months, he didn't exactly want to stop there. In fact, Drake dropped out of Cambridge University 9 months before graduation, stating as a response to a letter sent by his father who said that a degree was a safety net. If you manage to get a degree, at least you have something to fall back on. To which Nick responded by saying that a safety net is one of the things he did not want. This was the time when Nick started to perform in gigs, opening for Fairport Convention, and playing in sets with bands like Genesis and King Crimson. Unfortunately, people didn't find his performance to be very entertaining, especially since Nick didn't want people talking during his performance. This would ultimately lead Nick to retract from live performances altogether. This may be one of the many stigmas that would ultimately spiral Nick into a deep depression, but at the time, this was not a problem. Nick was still on a high after releasing his first album, and started work on his second album in 1970, hoping to boost the momentum that Five Leaves Left have made. By 1971, Nick's second album, Brighter Later, was released, which had more accessible and jazzier sound, but at the same time it still had that Nick Drake style of detail and precision. Despite this, it sold less copies than Five Leaves Left, only selling 3,000 units. Despite very positive reviews, this did nothing for his popularity, and this, like his shyness to live performances, would be another key factor on why he spiralled into depression. The album, despite its vastly different sound to his predecessor, is a fantastic album in my opinion, and it has some of his best songs. One of his songs, At the Chime of a City Clock, portrays the sights and the sounds of the bustling cities of London, which he moved to and then dropped out of Cambridge straight after, and how it's such a contrast to the peacefulness and tranquility of Tamworth and Arden, and the house that he used to live in, Farleys.
A city freeze, get on your knees, pray for warmth and green paper. A city drought, you're down and out. I see your trousers don't taper. I saddle up, I kick your feet. I ride the range of a London street. I travel to a local plane. Turn around and come back again. And at the chime of a city clock, I put up your roadblock, I hang on to your crown. For a stone in a tin can is wealth to the city man who leaves his armor down.
He showed potential since always, basically. And then in Brighter Later, I think he accomplished even more because his sound was more polished. Despite it sounding a little bit more poppy and having more strings, I still believe that it's an improvement on Five Leaves Left. One of my favorites is One of These Things First and Hazy Jane One. I think that they're showing the direction that he's going on.
Nick continued to perform in clubs, but people still wouldn't be quiet during his sets, which ultimately led Nick Drake to straight up leave the stage halfway through a set. Halfway through the song Fruit Tree, to be exact. sort of like something hit him at the moment. Unfortunately, things started to get even worse for Nick, as his frustration had soon converted itself into depression, and in 1971, he was persuaded by his family to see a psychiatrist, and then he was promptly prescribed antidepressants. But Drake felt ashamed and embarrassed to be taking them. His almost constant intake of marijuana didn't help things either, and people and fans have speculated on his regular use of the drug may have caused Drake to show the first signs of psychosis. Psychosis would have explained a lot of the diary entries that Nick Drake's father, Rodney, wrote, who had pointed out that there were even days when Nick would just sit at the dinner table without even communicating to anybody, with his head looking down and no emotion on his face whatsoever. He now rarely left his flat, only going out to occasionally buy drugs with the weekly pay that Island Records was paying him.
A friend of mine went to see him and he hammered on the door and there was no reply. So he went round the back of the house and looked through the window and there was Nick just looking at the wall. He was just looking at the wall. And he didn't want to tap on the window and disturb him, but he sort of just left and came and said, you know, he told me what about that and said, you know, he's a really strange guy sometimes. And Nick just seemed to become more isolated. You'd go and see him and the conversation would become uncomfortable and I would leave.
His last full-length, but not the last attempt at a full-length album, came in 1972, after his first bout of disappointment with the releases of Five Leaves Left and Brighter Later. Drake would spend most of the money given to him by Island Records for cannabis and was already showing the first signs of psychosis. During October 1971, Nick approached John Woods to start working on his third album, Pink Moon. The album was recorded in its entirety in two night sessions and consisted with only Nick's voice and guitar, with only one piano overdub on the title track. Everything else was just vocal and guitar. The album was also the shortest of Drake's records, only lasting 28 minutes. The songs are more bleak and seem to give out more meaning once you put into consideration the struggles that he'd been going through prior to making this album. Nick used the emotional stress and the subsequent depression to create his album. I believe this is not only one of the greatest folk albums of all time, but it even rivals being the single greatest album of all time, in my honest opinion. Of course, in terms of historical value, it doesn't come close to the significance of Sgt. Pepper or The Dark Side of the Moon, but Pink Moon has that timeless quality that very few albums have, even more so than the latter albums mentioned.
I saw it written and I saw it say, Pink Moon is on its way. None of you stand so tall. Pink Moon, then I get you all. And it's a pink moon. Yes, pink moon. Pink, 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 pink. Pink moon. Pink, 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 pink. Pink moon. So I written and I saw it say, Pink Moon is on its way. None of you stand so tall. Pink Moon, when I get you home, it's a pink moon.
It's one of the greatest folk albums ever, I believe. It's all straight on the guitar. There's no drums. There's nothing backing him except on the first track, but there's some piano. But it's only Nick Drake and his guitar. So the epitome of the singer-songwriter. And I think that this style, his style, is a great influence on everyone current on the singer-songwriter genre currently, because it's all about being intimate and being passionate and being personal about yourself on the song, about your feelings. And I think that on Pink Moon, the album, the whole album, he was that personal. He really dove into what his feelings were at the time, despite being vague. I think they show very, not so much clearly, but like they depict his state of mind at the time of recording.
After the album's release, Drake decided to retire from music, to the point where he even dabbled with other career opportunities. The events after the release of Pink Moon are vague at best, but thanks to the diary entries of his father Rodney, we can piece together the final few years of Nick's frugal life. There were days where he would knock on friends and acquaintances' doors and come in unannounced, sit on their sofas, sleep for a night or two, and leave without even talking a single word to them. His illness took his absolute worst when he ended up having a nervous breakdown in early 1972. This would spiral Nick's depression to an almost new low entirely. He was hospitalized for 5 weeks, and his family even considered electroshock therapy if it meant Nick could be happy again. Despite the rest of 1972 and 1973 being completely bleak and hopeless for Drake, in 1974, he rung up John Wood again for an attempt at a fourth album. The few recordings that have surfaced show the extent of how much he was struggling. Joe Boyd had been taken aback by the anger and bitterness that had manifested into Drake's mind, even quoting, "I had told him that he was a genius, and others had concurred. Why wasn't he famous and rich? This rage must have festered beneath that inexpressive exterior for years." The recordings got to the point where he couldn't even record with both his guitar and voice, so instead he had to record them separately. The last few songs tell an even bleaker story of depression and hopelessness that most of the songs in Pink Moon don't even rival. The songs in particular are Voice from the Mountain, Rider on the Wheel, Black Eyed Dog, Hanging on a Star, and the supposed last recording of Nick Drake, Toe the Line, which in itself seems ominous and foreshadows the death of Nick.
This day is the day that we rise or we fall. This night is the night that we win or lose all. This time is the time that we wait for a while. Year is the year that we wait with a smile. If you call, we will follow. If you show us, we can toe the line.
He was he had suffered from depression for a long time, and it really showed in some of his songs, especially on Pink Moon. Pink Moon, I think, is a really depressing album, but that doesn't make it any less great than what it really is.
Sadly, this is where the bittersweet story of Nick ends. In November of 1974, after years of severe depression, he overdosed on antidepressants and died in his sleep. The news of Nick Drake's death was never a large story because of his obscurity as an artist. It wasn't until years later that his popularity skyrocketed, and his story as a musician and a victim of his own illness had made him a sort of cult figure in a sense, in the face of the music scene that he represented.
Unfortunately, by the time he was getting, you know, better, when he was cheering himself up in a way, he was composing more, he was feeling better about himself, it was already too late, because then he happened to overdose on the pills, which I still believe it's an accidental death because of the reasons that I stated. He was getting better, he was feeling better, so I think that it was an unfortunate fatality for Nick Drake and an unfortunate fatality for the music world, because just imagine what could have come after Pink Moon. I mean, there was no way he could go down in quality. He was destined to just go up. Even if he stayed underground, even if he stayed, you know, relatively unknown, I think he would be really vindicated in the future, much like he is right now.
And as far as we know it, that's what happened to Nick Drake. There are still many different stories and cases given him by friends and acquaintances, but we can never be sure about what exactly is going on. Which makes Nick's story so interesting. I hope that as you're watching this short documentary about his life and the shortcomings of it, you can make your own assessment and hopefully feel a sense of empathy and warmth towards this man. Because he had come from a time where empathy for that sort of illness came far and few between. And now we rise, and we are everywhere.
I knew this guy had died 24 years ago, but I didn't realise exactly how timeless the recordings were done.
But it must be so frustrating to be that good and to have no recognition.
But some people thought he was actually playing here tonight.
Yeah.
It's pathetic that this recognition, which he was lamenting wasn't there in his lifetime, is actually not coming.
Right.
I think as far as the village is concerned, it's probably his sister who is better known, because she's been seen more and heard more in the village, particularly through the medium of television.
Contact stage door.
There's nothing anonymous about Nick, ever. And I remember him coming once to BBC rehearsal room. And he sort of sat at the table with me and the cast, and sort of a lowering presence. And gradually everyone left, because they didn't know what to say quite.
And now we rise from the ground. See, she flies. She is everywhere. See, she flies all around. So look, see the sights, the endless summer nights. Go